Hey, y'all, what's up? This is Chris.
And I'm John. We're from Blackstone Cherry.
And you're watching BareBonesMusic.com.
Hey, this is Charles for BareBonesMusic.com. I'm with Chris and with John of Blackstone Cherry. And guys, thanks for being back in Kentucky.
No problem, man.
I just want to point out, Chris has a very Johnny Cash, Barry Manilow thing going on today in his voice.
You know, I ain't been awake that long, and it's just deep.
It's all right, you're back home. No one's mind about that.
Yeah.
So you guys, you're about 2 hours from home right now.
Yeah.
What is it like for you guys when you come back to Kentucky? I mean, how do you feel? How are the fans responsive to you? How's it go?
It's always good, man. I mean, you know, when we play Kentucky, a lot of family comes up. You know, like my fiance came up with a carload of people, and, you know, some of our friends are coming up. A lot of girlfriends and everything are coming up. You know, family members, things of that nature. They always come up when we play, you know, because it's close. Because the majority of the touring we do is out of driving range, you know. I mean, we love playing in Kentucky. I mean, you know, people call it, you know, the bluegrass state, and it is by all means, but there's been some pretty damn good rock and roll come out of it too, you know.
Coming back to Kentucky is always great. The fans here are, they're always a little bit more intense than they are anywhere else in the States, because they're, you know, they're proud of us because we're from the same place they are. So, you know, they already have that connection. So it's good for us to be able to play for them, because, you know, there aren't that many Kentucky bands that have done it. You know, you've got the Headhunters, us, and couple country acts, that's about it.
You know, speaking of Kentucky Headhunters, you guys got a lot of influence from those guys early on. Talk about how that really helps you all. I mean, I guess from just equipment in, because a lot of guys, it's harder to find a place to play. Set up a band.
That was one of the major things, man. They had the practice house, which they had rehearsed in since the 60s when they were a rock band called Itchy Brother, and they did that up until the late 70s. And then they kind of took a little break and then formed the Headhunters. And it's down on John Fred's grandparents' farm. And it's the sanctuary of everything. You know, that's everything that is Blackstone Cherry. And, you know, they gave us that place to rehearse in. And Richard and Fred are always around hanging out when we're writing or rehearsing. And
it sounds like everybody was at Metcalf County High School then.
Everybody but Ben. Ben went to Barron County High School. Or went to Glasgow High School.
It's right next to
him. If I mess that up, he'll whip my ass, man. Yeah.
There's a big rivalry there.
Yeah.
So talk about that then. I mean, being able to see each other daily while you're going to school, knowing that you've got a passion for music.
Yeah.
How did that change things going in as a band?
It made us not do anything at school, you know. I remember first period class every day. I'd be in there for it was sociology my senior year. I would be in class for maybe 5 or 10 minutes, and I'd hear, John. And I'd turn around and look, and Chris would be standing out in the hallway with a pack of Marlboro Reds going like that, smacking the cigarette pack. We'd be like, all right. I'd be like, I need to go to the bathroom. Get up, we'd go into the bathroom, smoke cigarettes, talk about the band for the whole class period.
Man, and we literally practiced 6 days a week back then. You know, we practiced every day, but we'd take either Saturday off or Sunday off, depending on who had family stuff to do that weekend. Yeah. But it was 6 days a week. We would go down there right after school, practice from about 4 till about between 10 and midnight most nights. And, I mean, we put our work in, man. You know, we put our work in. We paid our dues. And, you know, we finally put our third album out. It came out May 31st, called Between the Devil and the Deep Blue Sea. And you know, we did things different this time. We wrote with some outside writers, and we went to California to record the album and stuff, which was good. It was a breath of fresh air, man, because we had recorded in Kentucky and we recorded in Tennessee, and we just kind of wanted to get out of the Southeast, you know, as far as recording goes. And going to Southern California was nice, man, because, you know, it was the first time we had traveled and we didn't have family members in the studio all the time. And All the comforts that we had were taken away, and it was, you know, just the band playing their songs, and we had to play them good. We didn't really have a choice.
Yeah. Now, wouldn't you say, though, that's kind of almost going back to the way you guys started then? I mean, four guys wanted to play some music.
Pretty much, yeah. I mean, early on with us, it was like the way – because Richard was always kind of like the mentor that would be there but wasn't there. Mm-hmm. He'd come in, you know, late at night. We'd be there from, you know, 3 o'clock in the afternoon, right as school got out. We'd get down to the practice house and we would write or, you know, rehearse whatever it was that we needed to do at the time. And you'd come in at like 10 o'clock at night, and then...
You'd either say, boys, that sucks. Or he'd say, now, boys, you got one there. You know what I mean? And
that's what he did. He never did the, I'm going to grab a hold of these guys and, like, mold them into anything. He just kind of sat back and told us, you know, when he thought it was good and when he thought it sucked.
Yeah.
You know? And that's all we've ever really needed was somebody to, like, coach us and, like, say, that's good, that's bad. Don't do that. Keep following that one. You know? And we'll just keep working in that direction until we nail it.
Because, I mean, you got to think, they were a band that... You know, blew up, were massive, and then had it all crumbled away, you know, because of a guy left the band. And, you know, having the knowledge of all that and watching all that, you know, from a personal perspective, you know, watching it when I was a kid, you know, always keeps in the back of your mind, you know what I mean? Like, we can't do that.
Does that give you all even more motivation? I mean, you're coming from a small town, you're coming from Kentucky, rock band from Kentucky. It's tough to make it, and now you've made it. I mean, I guess you guys don't take anything for granted then.
Hell no.
See, we don't even look at it like we've made it, honestly. I mean, we won't start saying we've made it until we've had a couple platinum records, you know, something that is like concrete evidence of, hey, we've, you know, we've solidified ourselves, exactly.
You know, you talked about you got three albums, formed in 2001, but the first album was 08, 09, and then the current album. Yeah. Talk about how this new album is going for you guys. I mean, I think it's peaked at 11 on the, or 29th on the Billboard, and then White Trash Millionaires at topped at 11.
Yeah, I mean, it's at 11 right now, and we're still gaining steam with it. You know, man, we're really happy with the new record, and we feel like we made the right decision and chose the right songs for the record. And, you know, bands have to grow. You know, I mean, to survive in this industry, and we feel like we picked the 12 songs that we thought represented the band and its best form where we're at right now. And, you know, we hope people continue to enjoy the album and, you know, hope to break the top 10 with White Trash Millionaire. You know, we're one away from doing that, so hopefully we can make that happen.
What is does that mean that you guys have made it when you break into the top 10, or is that platinum record still kind
of... Platinum record's still there. You know, the top 10 means we're actually going to make a little bit of money.
Yeah.
We don't have to worry so much, you know, mamas and daddies and all that are fed at the house, and, you know, you don't have to worry so much about that. But, you know, you see bands all the time that come out and they hit number one, and they have this great stride off that single, you know, and then...
Nothing.
Their second and third record comes out, and they've sold like 20,000 records collectively between the two of them, and you know.
Well, it sounds like you guys are so grounded in what you do. I mean, you really do respect that you are getting to perform and getting to do albums, and it's really refreshing because you don't hear that all the time.
Well, it's like when we first signed our deal, you know, our record label, management company, and even us were like, you know, we don't want this to just pop and blow up. Because the bands that do that normally disappear. We wanted it to be a building, you know.
Like it's a work in progress.
Whole foundation started and then, you know, build the rest of everything from there, you know. So that way when it does become the biggest thing in the world, it can stay there for a while.
I think just more than anything that, especially with the new record, you're getting to see more of just the four of our true personalities than anyone's ever heard before. Songs come out of you at certain times for a reason. I firmly believe that. And a lot of songs on this record, you know, really mean a lot to us. I mean, obviously there's songs like White Trash Millionaire and Blame It on the Boom Boom and Let Me See a Shake that are just, you know, just fun songs. But pretty much all the other songs on the record.
That's an eye-opening thing for our fans to see from us, because everything else we've done before has never been like...
Just a fun song.
Just a regular old fun song, you know. I mean, yeah, we've had songs like about drinking or whatever, like Yeah Man and Soul Creek and all that, is about drinking and hanging out, but never to that caliber, never to that extreme, just party song. We've never done that before. Everything's had a little bit more of a positive or serious angle, you know, instead of just being, hey, get drunk and have a good time, you know.
Yeah.
We've never done anything that blatant.
And why did you do that?
It just, like I said, man, you know, it's our personalities coming through more and more this time. And, you know, we had a year off to write, so there'd be days we'd go down and couldn't write anything, so we'd have a party that night instead.
And then the next day we'd write Blame on the Boom Boom. You know, stuff like that.
So, guys, make sure you follow, add, whatever you got to do on Facebook, Twitter, Blackstone Cherry. I'm Charles from airbonesmusic.com. Thanks so much.